Welcome to part 2 of my Hackintosh from start to finish series. I hope you guys enjoyed my last video, and so if you're watching this video, then that means that, you know, even after seeing the pros and the cons, you're willing to go ahead and give this a shot, spend some money, hopefully, and if you follow this video, you will get a great system. So as you can see from the title, this portion of the series is going to be dedicated to hardware. Now, that this is the most important factor of a Hackintosh, OS 10 is what it is. It'll install, but it won't install unless you have the correct hardware. Hardware is the absolute key here, and it's very crucial that you pick great components, because if there's something in your machine that's not supported, even just one thing, maybe as stupid as a little PCI card, it could cause your entire system not to boot unless you take it out. So while I'll say this for the rest of each portion of this series, for picking your hardware, it is probably the most crucial to do your research. When I was building my computer, I spent hours, like probably an hour or so every day, just on Newegg, on forums, on TonyMac, all these different websites, all these different forums, looking up compatible hardware, and I really stress that you do the same. There's nothing worse than spending money on a component just to find out when you boot it up that it doesn't work. And then you read online somewhere that, oh, it says this, that it doesn't work. And then you're just going to slap yourself in the head because you didn't research. So now that you know the importance of picking the right hardware and researching to pick the right hardware, I want to stress one big thing, is that to not spend more than you need. So let's say, for example, all you want to do on this computer, you just want to have, say, a designated OS 10 desktop, but all you want to do with it really is web browse, sync your iPhone with it, and browse photos in iPhoto. There's no need to go out and get a $300 Core i7. There's no need to run out and get a $250 Core i7 motherboard. You'd be fine in that case, say, with a Core i3, 4 GB of RAM, and, you know, a micro ATX board. There's really no need to go all out on a system that you're not going to use. If you're not going to use 8 cores, then don't buy 8 cores. You'd be fine with the dual core, I believe it's dual core with 4 threads, Core i3. Or if you want a little more than that, then go with the Core i5. That's one of the best things about building a Hackintosh. With Apple's desktops, like, you get what you get and they cost what they cost. So a MacBook costs this and you can do this with it. A Mac Pro costs this and you can do this with it. There's really no middle ground. I mean, even nowadays, the iMacs are right up there with the Mac Pros, not only in performance, but also in price. So when you're building a Hackintosh, you can build that middle ground computer that, you know, you don't want to do 3D rendering and video editing with, but you also want to do a little bit more than just web browsing. That's where the Hackintosh really shines, because you can really pick your hardware and price it accordingly. So as you saw last video, I have my little Hackintosh Bible here that I wrote, and this whole video is going to be pretty much based on different aspects of the hardware. For example, processors, motherboards, memory, power supplies, things like that. This is just going to give you my 2 cents on, when you're picking out these things, what to look for, what to buy, what not to buy, and etc. So let's just go ahead and get started with processors. So if you guys know, I'm currently running an Intel Core i7-930. The unboxing's on my channel. You can go ahead and watch that. It's from a while ago though, so don't expect great video quality. But I absolutely love this processor. I recommend any Intel chip. Now before you ask, AMD will not work. Yes, yep. There are ways of getting OS 10 to run on an AMD system, but you have to use a distribution, which is basically a hacked operating system. And so real quick, I'll just sort of explain the two. The installation that we're going to be using for the purpose of this video, the installation I use and the only installation I recommend, is a retail install. This is using an image that you downloaded from the Mac App Store, using a Snow Leopard DVD that you bought from Apple. You don't have to modify these images. Like, they install as is. The only thing that really differs a Hackintosh is the bootloader that emulates EFI, and we'll get into all that stuff later in the software portion of the series. But if you're watching this video, don't buy an AMD system. If you want a really reliable Hackintosh, don't buy an AMD system. If you decide to, if you've had good experiences with distros in the past, regardless of their pretty much lack of updatability, pretty much every update will pretty much trash your system until an update comes out. So I really don't recommend going that route. So if you do decide to build an AMD system, don't ask for my help with distributions, because I will not help you. So like I said, I'm using the Intel Core i7-930. It's a very fantastic chip. It does everything I throw at it very well, very fast. So basically what I'm trying to say is pretty much any Intel chip will work. Any Intel Core i3, Core i5, Core i7, even the 6-core i7s like the 980X, those will work very well for you. And the reason for this is because they're what Apple uses in their computers. Apple uses the i7 in pretty much every one of their Macs now. So keeping the Core I series in mind here, Sandy Bridge also works, which is the second generation of Intel's Core i7, i5, and i3 chips. So Sandy Bridge works just fine, but keep in mind if you want to have a Sandy Bridge processor, you need to have a Sandy Bridge motherboard. They're completely different sockets. For example, 1366, 1155, 1156, they're all different CPU sockets. Each motherboard has a different socket, so you really have to pay attention to that when you're buying. So for example, the Core i7-930 I'm running here is a 1366, it's an X58 system, so just remember that, 1366. And whenever you're looking for a processor, it will say that in the description what socket it is, and so if you have a 1366 processor, then guess what, you need a socket 1366 motherboard to fit it. So in case you guys couldn't tell by now, I highly recommend the Intel chips. Any Core I X series chips will work great for you. They're all pretty much supported out of the box. And now keep in mind, with such fast processors, you are going to put out some heat with these things. So every CPU comes with a CPU cooler. It's a heat sink, usually with a fan on it. I have an Intel one here that I don't use because I went third-party cooling. And this is, I'll talk about overclocking and everything in a later portion of this series, but when you just buy a CPU, like I said, they put off a lot of heat. So if you invest in a third-party cooler, it'll keep your processor running a lot cooler than the stock will. And the cooler you have your CPU, the longer it's gonna last you. And keep in mind, if you're buying a CPU cooler, make sure it's going to fit your case. A lot of these now are so big, such as the Noctua NHU12P. It's seriously like as big as my head. And if you get a small case, it's simply not going to fit unless you have like the side panel of your case off, which just doesn't look very appealing. So if you're going to buy a CPU cooler, make sure it'll fit your socket, make sure it'll fit on your motherboard, and make sure it'll fit your case. And now I know a lot of you, even though I said not to do this, you're probably going to want to try to install Hackintosh on an older system, with such as, you know, a Core 2 Duo, a Core 2 Quad, maybe even like a Pentium or a Celeron chip. As far as the Core 2 Quad and the Core 2 Duo, Apple used the Core 2 Duo for a long time, so it should work, but if you do a system like that with a Core 2 Quad or a Core 2 Duo, chances are the processor will work fine, but something on the motherboard won't, because Apple didn't use those types of motherboards. So maybe your USB won't work, or maybe your SATA won't work. Something just won't be right. You know, that's not a guarantee. That's just throwing in my two cents and saying I don't recommend using an older system. But if you do decide to, that's all on you. If you want to try it on like a Celeron or like a Pentium system, I don't recommend this at all, but if you want to, you're on your own. So now moving on to motherboards. Like I said, it has to have the right socket size for your processor. The board I'm using now is a Gigabyte X58A UD3R Revision 2. It's a very, very nice motherboard, and it's plenty of room for upgrades. It maxes out at like 24 gigs of RAM, more than I'll probably need for a long time. Lots of SATA ports. It even has SATA 3, USB 3, many great features of this motherboard, and so I highly recommend this motherboard, as well as pretty much any Gigabyte or Asus motherboards. A lot of those work fantastic, and a good way to check for a good motherboard is to go on to TonyMacX86.com. So as you can see here right now, I've pulled up the DSDT database. Simply browse around through here. Chances are, if it's in here, there is a DSDT for it, and you'll learn more about what that is. But basically, it means that this is pretty much confirmed working with this motherboard. That's a nice way of looking at it. If your motherboard is in this list, it will work. So you really don't have too much to worry about. Another thing to keep in mind with the motherboard is to look at how much RAM you want. And I say that because nowadays, a lot of motherboards either have 4 or 6 RAM slots. If you have 4, like an increment of 2, then that means it's pretty much like dual channel. So if you use a RAM in sets of 2, like say 4 gigs, 8 gigs, 16 gigs, then it'll be faster because it's in that even increment. But if you have a motherboard with 6 RAM slots, then you should use memory in increments of 3. For example, 3, 6, 12, 24, things like that. I have 6 with this motherboard, so I have 12 gigs of memory. Triple channel will really speed up the performance of your memory. So moving on to the next most important component, that would be the graphics card. I want to say right up front that I recommend AMD or ATI cards simply because they're easier to get working. The Chimera bootloader, and I know you probably, if you're watching this video and you don't know anything really about the Hackintosh, you won't know what that is, but I'll explain all this, I think, in my next video. I might do it the video after that, but we'll see. But anyway, back to the point. The Chimera bootloader supports ATI config and graphics enabler. So ATI cards just work a lot better due to frame buffers, which again, you'll learn later. But I recommend any AMD or ATI card. The Radeon HD 5770, right now I have a Gigabyte AMD Radeon HD 6850. It works very well. I'm trying to get triple displays. As you can see, my dual displays work great. But right now I'm sort of in the process of seeing if I can get 3 monitors so I can have a triple monitor setup. That'd be very cool. But at the end of the day, and while this is totally personal preference, I just prefer AMD cards. So I will probably won't be buying another NVIDIA card for a long time, but most of them do work, but I really don't pay much attention to NVIDIA cards. But I know there's NVIDIA put out some drivers for OS X for some certain cards. I'm not sure about the whole GTX, you know, 5XX, whatever the graphics cards are up to now. Like I said, I don't pay much attention to NVIDIA. But this is a key part where I have to stress that you have to do your research. If you go on Google, if you go on TonyMac, you can just Google the name of the card and put Hackintosh after it, and I'm sure you'll find your answer if it works or not. Now, for all you gamers out there, I know you're going to want to dual boot Windows and OS X. Maybe use OS X for your work and productivity, and just have Windows just for games. And a lot of you guys want to have like SLI setups, Crossfire. As far as I know, those are not supported. Some cards you can have two, but I don't believe you hook them up through the SLI or the Crossfire. You simply just have two cards plugged into your motherboard. Now, I'm really not sure how that works, if it would affect the game's performance. I'm really not a gamer at all. So, I mean, I have a PS3. You can probably see it over there. That's what I do my gaming on. I don't game on my computer basically at all. Moving on to memory, this is going to be fairly short because most memory does work great. Just look at your motherboard. It'll say whether it's like, say for example, 240-pin memory. Just go on Newegg, type in memory. It'll tell you how many pins it is, and chances are it would work. But like I said, pay attention to the RAM slots on your motherboard. Get dual channel or triple channel memory, DDR2, DDR3. It's very pretty much self-explanatory. I have 6 2-gigabyte sticks for a total of 12 gigs of memory. I have Corsair XMS3 memory. I could absolutely recommend it. All 6 sticks have been working great since last Christmas. I started off with 6 gigs of RAM and then upgraded to 12. Moving on to the power supply, again, this is just very short topic because I just want to say, don't just run and get a kilowatt power supply, because even a pretty high-end system like mine, I'm rocking a 650-watt power supply, and I still have a little bit of room on that for upgrading. So, I mean, there's no need to run up your electricity bill and go out and buy a kilowatt power supply when your system only needs half of that. So just do your research. What I recommend doing is taking probably the video card is probably what's going to eat up a lot of your power. Take the video card, what that recommends, add 50 to 100 to 150, that's kind of pushing it, but just add, say, around 100 watts to it, and that's about the power supply you should get. This card takes about 450, and I have a 650-watt power supply, so I added 200 on there, but I bought my power supply a while before I bought my graphics card. So what I recommend is just take your beefiest component, add on 100 to 150 watts, and you should be fine. Also, make sure that it fits your motherboard. A lot of them will even say i7 on it. Make sure that it works on an i7 board. A lot of the i7 boards will have a main connector and another like 6-pin connector that will go somewhere up top on the motherboard. Honestly, I'm not quite sure why that is, but that's just the way it is. So make sure you look for stuff like that when you buy a power supply. Make sure that it'll work with an i7 board. Moving on to hard drives. Hard drives are crazy expensive right now. I don't recommend buying them now because of the flooding over on the other side of the world. Hope they're all doing okay, by the way. But basically what I want to stress is solid-state drive versus hard drive. I currently have a solid-state drive. I have a plethora of videos on my channel. Go ahead and check those out if you're interested. I have speed tests and etc. But back to this video. I highly recommend getting a solid-state if you can afford it. Personally, I just have a 60GB for my boot drive. I just have my OS and my applications on there. Everything else I have on my other hard drives. I have a terabyte and a 500GB hard drive that I have all my music, videos, YouTube videos, pictures, stuff like that. All my media is stored on other hard drives, and I just have OS X and my applications installed on my solid state. But if you don't have the money, or you just don't want to jump on a solid state bandwagon yet, hard drives will work just fine. Moving on to DVD drive, again, this is another pretty short topic. The key components that take a while to explain are out of the way. This is just, you know, coming down to the last final things. The DVD drive is very easy to pick out. You can get one for $20. Just make sure that it's SATA. That's pretty much all you need. I mean, there's a lot of just, like I said, $15, $20 DVD drives. That will work great. If you want a burner, get a burner. If you want Blu-ray, not all Blu-ray burners work. There are a few, and you can Google around for those. But I know that for a fact that there are some that write Blu-rays, some that only read, some that just don't work. So like I said, just do your research if you're looking to go into Blu-ray. But just for my purposes, I don't have a Blu-ray drive. I would never use it. I just use DVDs. And the last subject I want to touch on is third-party hardware. This can include Wi-Fi cards, Bluetooth adapters, sound cards, you know, things like that. Not all of them work. And here's where, again, I stress that you really have to do your research. Look up a specific card that you're interested in, maybe that you find a good price on, and Google around, put Hackintosh. If you can't find anything, go to the TonyMac forums. There's a link right there. By the way, a lot of this wouldn't be possible without them, so definitely check out their forums, ask questions, get to know the people there. They're very, very smart people. But basically, not every third-party card will work. There's some that do. For example, I have a wireless card on my desktop here. I am running Ethernet, but some days like it acts up or something. I like to be able to switch over to Wi-Fi if necessary. So my Wi-Fi card does work. You can check my channel page for the specific card I have, which does work. So if you can find that exact card, I can verify that it works perfectly. But there are other Wi-Fi cards that simply don't. I also have like a USB wireless thing that does not work. That's why I bought this card. So say, for example, you're going to be using your Hackintosh for audio production and you need a lot of FireWire ports for mixers or anything like that. You can buy a FireWire card, like a PCI FireWire card that has 2 or 4 slots. Just research it, ask on the forums, or if you really can't find anything, a lot of these cards aren't that expensive, so maybe just take the $20 plunge and see if it works, and you'd be benefiting the community as well. But for general purposes, a lot of stuff can be found online. Just look up FireWire PCI card Hackintosh and you'll find a list that are supported. So that's pretty much it for picking out the hardware. I've gone over pretty much every key component, other than probably the case. I mean, when you buy a Hackintosh, you want it in a case, obviously. Just buy one that fits your motherboard. A lot of motherboards are ATX. There's also micro ATX. Make sure you just get a case that can house that motherboard. Again, that'll all be in the details when you buy the case. But pretty much other than that, I've gone over every component that I need to. I hope this helped you guys when picking out your hardware. Like I said at the beginning of the video, don't spend more than you need to. If you're just going to be browsing the web, syncing your iPhone, things like that, don't spend $1,500 on a system like I did. You know, I use this for everything. You know, I do high quality videos on YouTube, like, you know, 1080p editing, motion, very, very CPU intensive tasks. Multitasking all the time, so things like that. So I hope this video helps you guys pick out your hardware. If you've watched this far, then you're obviously interested in building a Hackintosh. So it's a great world to get in, but this is the key step right here, is picking out the right components. So I understand that if you guys are overwhelmed, if you have questions, please feel free to ask me. I'm at CPUKid on Twitter. Also, you can leave comments right below. You can message me. Pretty much any way you can get in touch with me, feel free to. So that pretty much wraps up the second part of my Hackintosh from start to finish series. I hope this helped you, and look for my next part of this video, which is going to be some things you need to know before installing OS X. See you then.